when I'm down. When the wolves come around, when my feet hit the ground.
I just need
you on my darkest day. When I'm losing faith, no, it ain't no change.
I just need you. Yeah, I just need you.
You pull me closer. I come to life when you pull me closer. I come to life when you pull me closer. I come to life when you pull me closer. I come to life.
Hey, yeah, yeah. Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, yeah, yeah. Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, I've been on a high note, running on a scale so major, swerving on them nitro, yeah, swerving on them nitro. Hundreds of dollars away, out of the way. Nothing hold me down low, cause I've been on a high note. Yeah, I've been on a high note. Ain't no coming down with you, baby. Ain't no coming down. Hey, yeah, yeah. Hey, yeah, yeah. High note. Hey, yeah, yeah. Hey, yeah, yeah. High note.
If this life has anything to gain at all, I'll count a loss if I can't hear you, feel you, cause I need you. Can't walk this earth alone. I recognize I'm not my own. So before I fall, I need to hear you, feel you, as I live to make my boast in you alone.
With every breath I take, with every heartbeat, sunrise or the moonlights in a dark street, every glance, every dance, every note of a song, it's all a gift undeserved that I shouldn't have known. Every day that I lie, every moment I covet, I'm deserving to die, I'm just earning your judgment. Without the cross, there's only condemnation.
Just want to invite you all, what did I just do? Sorry. I just want to invite you all, wherever you are, to just sing out loud. Nobody else can hear you. I'm the only one y'all can hear, so don't worry about it, all right? Thank you. Welcome to this place. Welcome into this broken vessel. You desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our hands and we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise unto your name. Welcome to this place. Welcome into this broken vessel. You desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our hands and we lift our hearts as we offer up praise unto your name. One more time. Welcome to this.
you desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our hands and we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise unto your name. There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He has risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall to my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when the darkness turns to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith will be my eye. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall to my knees. I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall to my knees and rise, and rise, and rise, and rise, and rise, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, go to my knees and rise, and rise. I will rise.
Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Let that be our prayer at this time, God. Help us to know that there's only a peace that comes from you, Lord. Help us be in that space in our heads, in our minds, in our spirits, God. I know, we know stuff is tough. We know, God, we're all going through the same thing. But, God, we also have you. And so help us right now, God. Because you have overcome the grave. You have risen from the dead. And you've called us by name. There will be no more sorrow, no more pain, God. Help us to fall to our knees before you, Lord, and to control the things we can and have faith that you have control of the things that we can't touch, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. I lost my capo. You see my capo anywhere over there? Oh, wait. Sorry. Praise Jesus. So did you notice the palms behind me? Palm Sunday, isn't that beautiful? We got those specially for you about 20 years ago. Yeah, we got palms over there too, but I didn't want to take them out. All right. The name of this song is I Will Bring Praise. So, and just have fun with it. It's called Desert Song, actually. And what's interesting about it is, you know, it's a fun, uppity song. But if you listen to the words, if you see the words, they're truth. They're for real. They're tough. And he's talking about, this is my prayer in the desert. When everything feels dry, you know, like if you're dry. I haven't driven around Manhattan in these days, but we're going to. I just want to experience it. But I can imagine it's like a desert space, right? If you've done it, I've seen some people post the videos and pictures. It looks like a movie. And so I want to experience that. But this is the singer, the writer of the song, saying, this is my prayer in the desert. When everything within me feels dry, my hunger and my need, my God is the one that provides. And so let's just keep that in mind as we sing, all right? This is my prayer in the desert. When all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. This is my prayer in the fire, in weakness and trial or pain. This is my faith, with the more worth than gold. So refine me, Lord, through the flame. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand. I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. Let's do the first verse again. This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. I will bring praise. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is me. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. Again. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. One more time. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. This is my prayer in the harvest. He starts off in the desert and now he's in the harvest. The desert, there's nothing. And in the harvest is plentiful. This is my prayer in the harvest, when favor and providence flow. I know I'm filled to be emptied again. The seed I've received, I will sow. Father, help us recognize that we go through desert times, but they're temporary, Lord. They're just temporary. These times are temporary. This too shall pass. Hallelujah. Maybe things will never be the same again, God, but that's okay because You're with us. You're with us in the desert. You're with us in the harvest. You're with us every time in between, God. And so help us to hold on to that, to have less anxiety over these things because You truly, truly are with us. Hallelujah. All right, I want to share something with you guys. Just give me 1 second.
Read rhymes like literature. Write lines, cause life isn't linear. All this disarray, when did this occur? Got me praying for rest like Whitaker. Cause I wanna be whole like an integer. So before I panic, I'ma pen the verse. Hit brother E up for the instrumental first. And let the governor know this is essential work. Don't fret lest you playing guitar strings. Looking at the news and I'm seeing bizarre things. Some of it's jarring and some it's alarming. Would've gave up if it wasn't for the comfort that God bring. And y'all be giving me hope too. I watch you more than Netflix and Roku. Oh shoot, man, I shouldn't have told you. Something special about a vessel when they really have no clue. No telling what my pencil and jot. Since Broadway is closed, I'ma give you the props. Yo, I get a lot of love, so I give it a lot. I am very much aware, I won't pretend that I'm not. Yo, this tune struck a chord and hit a sensitive spot. Cause my heart's been getting cold like when the temperature drops. A lot of peeps cry tears, so I'm getting them off. To give what I got to all who listen and watch.
All right, Rand. Our speaker today is Randy Mason. I'm excited for that always. So take it away, brother.
What's up? What's up? Good morning, everybody. Live in the place to be. Let me see. I'm trying to get my view right here. Man, let me get a thumbs up if y'all can hear me. Can everybody hear me? Oh, that looks dope. I should have screenshot that. That's okay. Welcome to Zoom Church. Elements Church. I appreciate y'all for joining. Good morning. We're also live on Instagram. Thank y'all for joining us. And whatever else E is streaming it, probably on Facebook and all that. Man, let's pray and let's get into this word. Amen. Father, we thank you for this day that you have made and uniquely designed for your glory. I'm so grateful for everybody online right now and just grateful for an opportunity to connect. And to see all of these beautiful faces and families. And man, this is such a unique opportunity. And so we just pray that you do something awesome, that it not be in vain. I pray that each of us would walk away from this time better than the way in which we came to it. Thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, y'all. So welcome to Elements Church. Thank you for joining us. I hope that everybody is well. Truthfully, I know that everyone is not well. There's a lot going on, and I understand that this has been a really difficult time for many of us. Last night, I got to hear firsthand a healthcare worker's story. E and I were on a Zoom call with some friends, and I got to hear firsthand what's going on out there, and it was concerning, you know? So I know that it's a very difficult time. And that's why my objective today is to not only encourage you, but to equip you, you heard? Not only to encourage you, but to equip you with what you need, with the tools necessary for the task at hand. And yes, I did say task at hand because you have a task, you have a task, I have a task. God has assigned us, each one of us, with a task. In the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it says, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." All right? Now, the good work that you were created to do is an essential work. So you can let the governor know it's an essential work. The governor can't pardon you from this work. Social distancing doesn't prevent you from this work. Being at home doesn't disqualify you from this work. As everybody here knows, school has been canceled, concerts are canceled, churches have been canceled, but your purpose has not been canceled. Your destiny has not been canceled. God's plan for your life has not been canceled. It's very much still in full effect. And therefore, we need to do what we're doing right now. And that is renew our minds daily. We need to encourage one another daily. I appreciate everybody who's been reaching out. We need to equip ourselves daily with the word of God so that we can continue the work that God has given us to do. Amen? Amen. All right, so yo, we are approaching the end of a preaching series that we are calling I Am. right? Somebody say, I am.
Mr. Johnson.
Boom. And so I am is all about the seven I am statements that Jesus made as recorded in the Gospels, right? So why is the phrase I am so significant? I'm glad that you asked. In the Old Testament, God chose a man named Moses to liberate his people from slavery, right? And when he did that, Moses was like, cool. Actually, he agreed reluctantly. And he said, well, when I go to free the people, who should I tell them sent me? And God said, I am that I am. Tell them that I am sent you. You ever talking to somebody and they're like, yo, tell your mom I said hello. Tell your family, da da da. You're like, yeah, I got, what's your name again? So Moses was like, I got it, but who should I say sent me? And God said, I am. My name is I am. So I am is essentially a name of God. All right? Over 1,000 years later, we find Jesus using the very same language in the gospel, saying over and over and over again, I am, I am, I am. Basically identifying as God in the flesh. I think it's noteworthy to add that Jesus's language expressed his lineage. You heard? Jesus's language expressed his lineage. Each time that Jesus said, I am, he was giving a glimpse of where he was from, right? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I am the light. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the vine. I am the resurrection. Shout out to Pastor E and Erica and Pastor Danny, for preaching their parts of the series. If you missed those sermons, we can send you a link. They're available somewhere. But the title of today's message is Divine. D-I-V-I-N-E, divine. Say divine. Divine, which can be defined as proceeding directly from God. Okay, divine, proceeding directly from God. And I titled the sermon Divine because I believe that what we need now, perhaps more than ever before, is life that proceeds directly from God, something that is divine, right? So in the Gospel of John, chapter 15, that's where we're going to be spending some time. But in the Gospel of John, chapter 15, Jesus, he teaches his followers how to tap into the divine. Okay? And fortunately, for a wordsmith like me, Jesus uses an agricultural analogy about a vine, right? About a vine. Not just any vine, but the vine. Okay? The vine. In other words, the way to access the divine is to be attached to the vine. Okay? You follow me? Sometimes you got to go back in order to go forward. So we're actually going to start in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 4, verse 38. I know it's been a while. You're like, second, what? Where's that? 2 Kings in the Old Testament. Just keep going. Keep going, keep turning the pages, or if you're on the Bible app, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 38, okay? Remember, the title of today's message is Divine, okay? And Jesus, what we're going to learn later, Jesus teaches that the way to access life that is divine is by attaching yourself to the vine. Got it? All right. Here we go. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 38. Elisha. All right. Elisha came back to Gilgal during a famine in the land. Okay. Let me pause there real quick. Now, I've never experienced a famine, thank God. But I imagine that there are some similarities between a famine in the land and a pandemic in the land. One of which might be empty shelves at supermarkets. I don't know if y'all have seen any empty shelves at supermarkets. Another might be lines wrapped around the blocks and around the parking lot at Aldi and BJ's. I don't know if any of y'all seen anything like that. Another similarity might be mass panic, fear, and selfishness. I mean, self-preservation. you know, like buying all the toilet paper and all that stuff, right? So I think there are some similarities between a famine in the land and a pandemic in the land, all right? So Elisha came back to Gilgal during a famine in the land. And it says that the sons of the prophets were sitting before him, and he said to his servant, put on the large pot and cook stew for the sons of the prophets. People are hungry. People need nourishment, all right? Verse 39, then one of them went into the field to gather herbs and found a wild vine and gathered from it a lapful. He grabbed as much as he could get, a lapful of wild gourds, and came and cut them up into the pot of stew, although they did not know what they were. Okay? So they served it to the men to eat, but as they ate the stew, they cried out, O man of God, there is death in the pot. And they could not eat it. There was a famine in the land. People were beginning to panic. People were beginning to get desperate. People needed nourishment. People needed to, needed life, sustenance. And so the prophet said, yo, the people, go get what the people need. And his servant went out and he found a wild vine. And he grabbed as much as he could and he gave it to the people, not knowing that there was death in that vine. So, people are in desperate need of life and spiritual nourishment, right? That is divine. But like Elisha's servant, some of us are running to the wrong vine, the vine of fear and the vine of doubt and worry, the vine of greed, the vine of indifference or self-indulgence, the vine that overpromises and underdelivers every time. People are settling for whatever they can find and consuming whatever comes across their feed right now. It's happening right now. All right. Elisha said, go and get some food for the people. And they went and they found a wild vine, right? But there was death in that vine. Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was delightful to look at and a tree to be desired in order to make one wise and insightful, not to honor God, not to love God and her neighbor, but to make herself wise and insightful, she took some of the fruit and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband with her, and he ate it. Now, if you are familiar with the scripture, you know what happened after that, right? We're actually experiencing the results of that action right now. And just like in Elisha's day, there are vines today that produce strange fruit, fruit that ultimately leads to death and to ruin, okay? But this morning, we've come together to talk about another vine, a vine that is divine, the vine that leads to life, a life that honors God and a life that is full and complete and overflowing with joy. I don't know if that interests you, you know what I'm saying? A life that honors God and is full, complete, and overflowing with joy. That's what we're going to talk about this morning. Even in the middle of a famine or a pandemic or any other crisis, because it is a life that is divine, meaning it proceeds directly from God, all right? So now we're going to go to John chapter 15, and we're going to begin at verse 1. All right, let's see what we're doing here. John chapter 15, verse 1. Jesus is teaching his followers, okay? He's teaching, and he says, I am the true vine. Now, normally I would just gloss right over that statement, but as I was reading it this week, I said, hold up. I am the true vine. That word true implies that there are other vines. He's saying, I am the true vine. He's saying, beware, be alert, I am the true vine. In other words, there are other vines that can produce fruit in our lives, fruit that does not honor God, fruit that does not produce joy, okay? Jesus said, I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser. The vine dresser is the caretaker of the vine, the one who tends to the vine, the branch, and the fruit. Verse 2, if you're with me, say amen. Amen. Verse 2, Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, God takes away. Every branch that continues to bear fruit, he repeatedly prunes so that it will bear more fruit, even richer and finer fruit. Now, as you can probably imagine, pruning is an unpleasant process, okay? Pruning is the cutting away of everything and anything that might inhibit the vine from flowing freely. The removal of every wasteful part of the branch, even those that to us seem very promising. Pruning is God uprooting from our hearts and lives things that hinder growth, okay? I was looking at, I won't go there. Pruning is an unpleasant process, all right? But according to the scripture, that is the result of bearing fruit. So when you're where you're supposed to be, God will continually prune you so that you will bear even more fruit, even richer and finer fruit, okay? Hopefully that encourages somebody, because sometimes we're going through hardships and these difficulties and we don't really understand why, and we think something is wrong, but on the contrary, something may be right, actually very right, because if God sees that you are bearing fruit, God will continue to prune you. And pruning is not pleasant. Pruning is not fun. Pruning is the stripping away. Pruning is the cutting off. Pruning is the getting rid of. And anytime God begins to get rid of things from my life or cut things out of my life, it's a very challenging time. But it's indicative that God sees something and he is producing even richer and finer fruit. So that we might bear more fruit. Now, it's important to note that the phrase bear fruit, this is important, don't miss this. The phrase bear fruit does not mean produce fruit. To bear is to carry, to show, to display the fruit that flows from the vine, okay? We are not the manufacturers of or producers of fruit. We are the bearers of fruit. Okay, because sometimes we can get really frustrated because we're trying to produce the fruit that we can't produce. The vine produces the fruit. We are the branch that is called to bear, to carry, to show, to display the fruit. Just like we are not God, but we bear the image of God. You understand? Verse 2, every branch that continues to bear fruit, say fruit. God repeatedly prunes so that it will bear more fruit. Say more fruit. There are two notable progressive manifestations in this passage. Two things that we're going to see like this exponential growth, right? The first is fruit, more fruit, much fruit. Okay? Fruit, more fruit, much fruit. The other we're going to read a little bit later in the passage, and that is joy that is full, complete, and overflowing. Joy that is full, complete, and overflowing. Verse 3, Jesus is speaking. You are already clean because of the word which I have given you, the teachings which I have discussed with you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. Excuse me. Now, that word remain is sometimes translated as abide, which means to stay, which ultimately has to do with obedience. To abide is to obey. Because to stray or to walk away from or to leave is ultimately to disobey everything that we've been learning up until that point, right? So to remain is to stay, is to abide, is to obey. So Jesus said, remain in me, okay? Remain in me, and I will remain in you. The clause is cause and effect. You hear me? The clause is cause and effect. The latter part is the promise. The first part is the means of accessing the promise. We got to understand the language here. Jesus said, remain in me and I will remain in you. There's a cause and effect happening there. The latter part is the promise. The promise that will be fulfilled so long as the conditions are met. It said, Jesus said, remain in me and I will remain in you, okay? There's the promise and there's the means of accessing that promise. The promise is available to everyone, to anyone, all of the time. But if we disregard the means of accessing that promise, it'll never be fulfilled in our lives. Verse 4. Just as no branch can bear fruit by itself without remaining in the vine, neither can you bear fruit producing evidence of your faith unless you remain in me. I'm reading from the Amplified Version. Verse 5. Jesus is speaking. I am the vine. You are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him bears much fruit. Say much fruit. For otherwise, apart from me, that is cut off from vital union with me, you can do nothing. So what kind of fruit is Jesus even talking about here, right? Because this all this agricultural analogy is interesting. It's great word pictures. But what kind of fruit should we be expecting God to produce in our lives if we remain in him? Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love, unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience, not the ability to wait, but how we act while we're waiting. Should I repeat that one? Patience, not the ability to wait, but how we wait. Okay, how we act while we're waiting. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. This is the fruit that God desires to produce in you and through you. This is the fruit that God desires for you to bear, to carry, to show, to display, not to produce in your own strength because you can't. And that's why a lot of people say, yo, I tried this Christian life and it didn't work. It wasn't real. That's because sometimes people try to produce from their own strength and their own morality and their own goodness. They try to produce fruit that is divine. And if it's divine, it can only come from the vine. You understand? Jesus is saying, you can't even produce the fruit. I'm not asking you to produce the fruit. I'm asking you to remain in me so that I can produce the fruit through you. That you can display the fruit, bear the fruit, carry the fruit. So when people walk down the street and they see the tree and they see the fruit, you are bearing the image of God. You did not produce that fruit. God produced it in and through you. There's a big difference. Verse 6. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown out like a broken off branch and withers and dies. And they gather such branches and throw them into the fire and they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, let me rewind. Jesus said, apart from me, you can do no good. Jesus said, I am the vine, the source of divine life. So apart from that, we have no life source. So ultimately, amen. Ultimately, the outcome and the end result is bleak. That's a really challenging passage to read. I was going over it. I'm like, what am I going to say there? That is so like depressing. But truthfully, if we are disconnected from the vine, then we cannot expect life that is divine. And since we are all made in the image of God and created for God's glory, if we detach ourselves from God's perfect plan and will for our lives, we can expect nothing but ruin. And that's challenging. But I didn't write it, so don't get mad at me. Verse 7, if you remain in me and my words remain in you. So here, we're getting some more clarity. It's like, okay, Jesus, all right, now you're beginning to break this thing down a little bit further. If you remain in me and my words remain in you. In other words, to remain, to stay, to abide in Christ is to have his word inside of us. Remember, Jesus is the word. In John 1:1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is saying, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, that is, if we are vitally united and my message lives in your hearts, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. That's awesome. He said, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Remember, we're talking about cause and effect. Sometimes we fail to realize that God placed laws in the universe that cannot be broken. God said, if you do this, this is the result. That's why Jesus used the agricultural analogy, because these are laws that God put in the universe. When you plant the seed and you do X, Y, and Z, the outcome is what it's going to be. And Jesus is saying, in the very same fashion, if you remain in me, if my words remain in you, then there's an outcome on the other side of that thing. There's a promise. There's something that's going to happen based on that action. If you remain in me, verse 7, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Verse 8, my Father, God is glorified and honored by this. This is where it gets real good. We're coming toward the end of the teaching in the passage. Jesus is saying, my Father is glorified and honored by this. By what? When you bear much fruit. Say much fruit. We talked about fruit. We talked about more fruit. Now we're at the point we're at much fruit. Jesus is saying this is when God is honored. This is when God is glorified. When you bear much fruit. Remember, bear does not mean produce. Bear means to carry, to show, to display what God has produced through you. Okay? My Father is glorified and honored by this. When you bear, carry, show, display much fruit and prove yourselves to be my true disciples or students or followers. I have loved you just as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. Jesus said, remain in my love. In other words, he said, you got to stay in my love. He said, remain in my love and do not doubt my love for you. So many of us doubt God's love for us, and we don't realize that in doubting God's love for us, we're breaching the agreements. Because he said, don't doubt my love for you. Remain in my love. And then on the other side of that thing is the promise. So when we're doubting God's love, it's like we're putting a wall between us and the promise and the fulfillment of what God is trying to do in and through our lives. He said, don't doubt my love for you. Remain in my love. And how do we do that? It's by having his words inside of us. David said, I hide your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. He said, I take your word. He said, I take your word and I put it in my heart that I might not sin against you. So when I'm out and about, your word is in my heart. When I got no Wi-Fi and I can't connect to the Bible app, and when I can't find my actual Bible, your word is in my heart that I might not sin against you. So now if your word is in my heart and I don't sin against you, that means I'm remaining in your love. That means your word is remaining in me. And that means that I'm going to bear, carry, display, show much fruit, and God is going to be glorified and honored. It gets better. Do not doubt my love for you. Yo, don't doubt God's love for you. Do not doubt my love for you. If you keep my commandments and obey my teaching, you will remain in my love. Remember what I said earlier, the word remain sometimes is translated as abide, which means to stay. But ultimately, it has to do with obedience. To abide is to obey. If you take your dog off the leash and you tell the dog stay, and the dog runs off, the dog is not abiding. The dog is not staying. The dog is not obeying. The dog is out. You understand? Abide. That means walk with me. Keep my commandments and obey my teaching, you will remain in my love. If you keep my commandments and obey my teaching, you will remain in my love. This is essentially a how-to. Jesus is giving us a step-by-step how-to, which personally, I love. I like to make lists of like exactly how I'm going to do what I need to do. In order to get to this end result, what needs to happen? What do I need to do? Like reverse engineer. If I want to glorify God, if I want to honor God, if I want joy in my life that is full, complete, and overflowing, if I want to bear much fruit, love, joy, peace, all that kind of stuff, that's the end result. So sometimes we get stuck on that trying to figure it out. You got to reverse engineer, but you got to go backwards and say, okay, Jesus, so what do I need to do to get there? And he's giving us the how-to. He said, remain in me, and I will remain in you. He said, abide. He said, obey. He said, rock with me, and you're going to see this come to fruition in your life. Verse 11, I have told you these things. I love it. I love when Jesus does something like this. He's like, all right, I said all of that. Here's why I said it. Isn't that awesome? This is the reason why I'm telling you this. It reminds me of like talking to the kids. You're like, yo, boom, 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 boom. You're giving them these instructions and stuff. And they're like, yeah, all right, what? And you're like, listen, this is why I'm telling you this. Okay? Jesus said, I have told you these things so that, say so that my joy and delight may be in you and that your joy may be full, complete, and overflowing. I don't know if that excites anybody. Jesus is saying, I told you all of this so that my joy might be in you and that your joy might be full, complete, and overflowing. In other words, this message is not only for God's glory, and that is sufficient and enough, but it's not only for God's glory, it's also for your good. Just like Jesus's language expressed his lineage, the branch exists only to express the purpose of the vine. The branch, that's you and I, exists only to express the purpose of the vine. The branch has no other function but to bear that which the vine is producing. That's the only function of the branch, is to bear the fruit that the vine, the purpose of the vine, which is the fruit. So the vine that is divine, meaning proceeds directly from God, is our source of spiritual, nourishment and empowerment. Amen. When we remain and abide and fulfill the purpose, that essential work that God prepared for us to do, his life-giving spirit flows freely in and through us, producing fruit, more fruit, much fruit, so that our joy might be full, complete, and overflowing. And in this, God is honored and glorified. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for making it simple and clear. We thank you for giving us a how-to. We thank you for loving us in the way that you do. And I pray that this word that we just experienced, God, I pray that you would cause it to bring divine life into our lives. I pray that you would continually prune and produce fruit, more fruit, and much fruit in the lives of everybody who's watching now and anyone who might watch later. Anybody who hears this word, God, I pray that you produce in their lives, through their lives, fruit, more fruit, and much fruit, and that their joy be full, complete, and overflowing, so that the world might taste and see that you are good. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and everybody in the place said, amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Randy. That was beautiful.
Amen.
I'm excited to see what comes of these sermons, man. I am the I Am series. It's beautiful stuff. So next Sunday is Easter, and we want to encourage you to get a little bit of some grape juice or something and get yourself a piece of bread that you can eat. We are going to take communion together next week, Sunday. We're taking communion together. That's exciting to me to see how it's going to work out. We will figure it out as we go along, but just have something that you can take communion from. All right. Did I have any other announcements? I don't remember. Hey, please keep giving online. Everything's on the website, elementschurch.com. You could give by PayPal, or you can give by text as well. And if you're already a regular giver, please don't stop. Thankfully, we're okay because you guys give online. So keep doing that so that God can bless us, and we'll hit the ground running when we get back. You know what I mean. When we get back to regular. Randy has prayed us out. Our service is officially over, but you know how we do. We're going to hang. I'm going to unmute everybody, and, you know, you stay. Look at Erica, all happy now. She's ready. She's ready to talk. Yeah, it's great. It's elements. It's just service. So God bless you, Randy. Thank you for a beautiful, beautiful word. Thank you for everyone who's watching. We got a bunch of people been watching with us on Facebook Live. That's why we saw me keep going like this, the phone. I'll explain another time. But God bless you all. And listen, one other thing I wanted to say, if any of you need anything, please do not hesitate to ask. We have people, me, you see Marilyn, she already delivered a care compra to us. It was supposed to be a care bag, but you know how Marilyn do. But if you need anything, please do not hesitate. If anybody needs anything, please. I don't wanna get into business here, but you can hit me up. We'll make sure we try and figure it out. All right? So if you're leaving, God bless you, but we're gonna stay on. Anybody, I'm gonna unmute everybody, okay?
In the room, get your hands way up, airborne like you flew them. When the world get ugly, get buck nutty. Hold your position, remember the mission. Lock and load, truth be told, Jesus is the only hope for your soul. Get it? Got it? Good. I'm robbing the hood, taking what's rightfully mine up out of the hood. Nah, Todd ain't signed, I ain't out of the woods. Just Christ co-signed, so it gotta be good. I'm praying for goons and wannabe thugs. Young girls stripping who just wanna be hugged. You can get that here in the house of the Lord, no matter what you wear. Forget them trying to judge your gear. They slow, just look at them weird and come on in. Welcome to Sunday service. Please ignore the Sunday circus. We deal with people hurting. Piece of work, but man, it's worth it. Leave home your Sunday's best. Our new dress code is jeans and t-shirts. It's not the outer appearance, the heart is Christ's main concern. I, Todd, hype God and leak his message through your iPod. Share the good news on my blog. Log on toddbangs.com. Catch the bang boogie, now up jump the boogie. Truly worshiping in boost jeans and hoodies. Rep Christ for Sheezy, please believe me. To the rhythm of the boogie to be.